Bonjour Alix.
Bonjour Margot.
Un peu d'optimisme ce matin, le niveau d'épargne mondial donne de l'espoir pour l'après-Covid.
Oui, d'après une étude produite par l'agence Moody's à eux tous. Et depuis le début de la pandémie, les consommateurs du monde entier auraient accumulé 5 400 milliards de dollars d'économies. Ils seraient aussi de plus en plus confiants quant aux perspectives. Au premier trimestre 2021, l'indice mondial de confiance des consommateurs du Conference Board a atteint son plus haut niveau depuis les records de 2005. Des hausses qu'on remarque dans toutes les régions du monde, d'où la croyance en un fort rebond des dépenses. D'après Mark Zandi, chef économiste chez Moody's, il a été interviewé par le Financial Times. Le combo demande refoulée plus excès d'épargne égale une forte augmentation des dépenses de consommation à mesure que les pays s'ouvrent.
Et qu'est-ce que l'étude nous apprend d'autre, Alix ?
Qu'il suffirait que les consommateurs dépensent environ un tiers de leurs économies excédentaires pour augmenter la production mondiale d'un peu plus de 2 points pour les 2 années à venir.
C'est paradoxal, non, au regard de l'année écoulée ?
Oui, c'est vrai. En 2020, l'économie mondiale a subi sa plus forte baisse de production dans l'histoire moderne. En fait, la situation s'explique grâce au programme de relance. Ils ont, pour certains pays, été tels que les revenus des ménages auraient été largement protégés. L'autre facteur de ce niveau d'épargne, c'est que crise oblige. Et face à toute l'incertitude qu'elle provoque, les consommateurs ont réduit leurs dépenses, sans compter les fermetures d'entreprises, de services qui ont fait office en fait, de coup de pouce pour les consommateurs pour réduire leurs dépenses.
C'est du jamais vu ?
C'est inédit, oui. D'après l'OCDE, en 2020, les taux d'épargne des ménages de certaines économies ont atteint leur plus haut niveau ce siècle. Et avec eux, les dépôts bancaires ont augmenté. Ne serait-ce qu'aux États-Unis, les ménages ont accumulé plus de 2 000 milliards de dollars d'épargne supplémentaires, sans compter que c'était avant les transferts géants du programme de relance de 1 900 milliards de Biden.
Un optimisme à nuancer tout de même.
Oui, toutes ces infos sont à relativiser. Tout ça, on s'en doute, concerne les ménages les plus riches. L'indice de confiance des consommateurs Morning Consult a montré que la proportion des ménages à faible revenu dont la situation financière s'est détériorée, eh bien, elle a augmenté par rapport à il y a un an. Donc cette étude, c'est aussi un révélateur d'inégalités.
Merci Alix Nguyen pour ces précisions. Le Bitcoin doit-il craindre les foudres des régulateurs ? L'arrivée de Gary Gensler fait débat, on vous en parlait dès hier. Sa réputation d'interventionniste est redoutée. Let's hear more from the executive director of the Blockchain Association regarding potential regulations for crypto.
We certainly have our work cut out for us. You know, the Blockchain Association, it's our job to engage with policymakers, and we've been doing that for almost 3 years now. Our organization has grown, our membership has grown, the industry has grown, and they're putting more resources to play in Washington, which is a fantastic thing. And so, you know, with Bitcoin is a scarce digital asset. There will only ever be 21 million Bitcoin. And, you know, there are a lot of people out there that find that valuable. There are a lot of people that decided to buy on the dip over the weekend. And, you know, I think that over time that those people in government that don't yet understand digital assets will. We're working to get to as many of them as possible. But more importantly, now that we have Coinbase, a publicly listed company, you know, the markets are sending validation to the fact that they're validating the idea that crypto is an industry that is growing. It is something that, you know, 56 million users and Coinbase want to have access to. And so I think we've turned a corner, and going forward, it's not going to be in this sort of denial phase, but in the what can I learn about this and what's the right way to regulate it type phase.
And how do you view China and their plans? Would it, on the one hand, we've heard that they actually want to support Bitcoin because it destabilizes the dollar, but then they're also going to have perhaps their own digital currency. Are they good for Bitcoin, bad for Bitcoin? Bitcoin, it doesn't matter what they are, Bitcoin is going to stand on its own?
I mean, Bitcoin's going to stand on its own regardless. I mean, Bitcoin is a very different type of cryptocurrency than a central bank digital currency. Bitcoin, you know, even though it was sort of conceived as electronic peer-to-peer cash, it really seem to be more of a store of value or some sort of an investment that's a hedge against inflation. Central bank digital currencies are really, I think, designed to facilitate payments and modernize fiat currency. And so, you know, there are so many different types of cryptocurrencies out there. All of them have different functions. And so for purchasers or those who are investing in cryptocurrencies, they really need to look at what is the underlying network that drives the value of the cryptocurrency, because that is... that is going to dictate,
On vous en parlait la semaine dernière, des rumeurs circulaient autour du recrutement d'un nouveau PDG pour GameStop. Cette fois-ci, c'est officiel, George Sherman démissionne. It will be effective as soon as a successor is found, but no later than July 31st.
We've got breaking news just out involving video game retailer GameStop. CEO George Sherman stepping down effective as soon as a successor is found, but no later than July 31st. No specific reason was given, although the company noted in an SEC filing that it's been evaluating executive leadership to ensure that the right skills, they say, are in place for a changing environment. That stock up now about 6% on that news alone. And the GameStop saga does not end. I think a lot of people thought that Ryan might take the role. It sounds like he's not going to, but clearly they're on a path to changing the dynamic of what that company looks like. Again, I'm not sure anybody really knows, though, what that company will look like.
Yeah. $10 billion market cap now.
Let's get you up to speed.
Yep.
Yeah, right.
And when you look at something like Coinbase, it's, you know, makes you, you know, was Coinbase worth 100 or close to it? And then maybe GameStop is. You know, I don't try to figure anything out anymore in terms of valuation, because there are quite a few companies, 50, 60, 70 billion, that I barely know what they do. So, I mean, at least I know GameStop. There's one near my house. I can see it and go touch the brick and mortar. I don't know whether that's good. But what, at 400, so it was 40 billion. So now 10 billion, is that? What do we think of $10 billion? Is it $10 billion with Ryan sort of calling the shots and a new CEO? Is that not, maybe that's not crazy, Zorkin, is it? Becky?
It depends where the company looks like 2 years from now.
Trade.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you want to look at the recovery trade, too. I was listening this morning, and 80% of the S&P 500 is now trading at least 10% above where it was pre-COVID. So you're looking at a lot of rebound, not just bouncing back from the distress that we saw when things shut down, but most of these stocks are doing much better than they had been doing before COVID. And you just wonder if that's something that makes sense and something that can last, or if something that's kind of getting ahead of where we maybe should be on some of these issues. That's just something to watch out for. Not saying that the market's going to crash or anything else happening, but it does start to make you wonder how much room there is left to run when that's the situation.
Et tout de suite, Unexpected avec Cossé Labouèche.